there's discrepancy between coopers and distillers of how much flavor comes from the barrel and how much comes from the actual distilling process. But we think it's around 80% of the flavor, but we're the coopers. This is how our wood comes in over here. So this is export grade wood. Has no sap wood, no knots. It's better than furniture grade quality. This was cut on 9/21 of 2015. This is almost 5 year old wood, which is unheard of in the barrel industry. Usually wine barrels are 24 to 36 months. I mean, we're 36 to 48 months and doing it for whiskey. That's why we're getting such great flavors. You can see how gray it is. The pollen in the air and the bacteria and the molds that grow on this out in the field. This is aged in Missouri. Missouri wood produces some of the best flavors in the United States. So the rain, the snow, and it washes those tannins out. Makes them much more mellow, produces much better flavor. This is already plain. It's convex and concave. You can see it's the shape. And then after that, what he's doing is joining. Each piece is hand delivered to that machine, and the cutter head moves around the board instead of the board moving through the machine. This machine sets up the correct angle for the sides, for the diameter of barrel, and it's very accurate from end to end. White oak, it's very impervious to rot. It has what's called a tylose in it, and it will actually seal off the grain of the wood. It is watertight, and it has been used for aging spirits for hundreds and thousands of years, really. We table every single barrel so that we know the exact sizes. We lay our staves out on that table in a geometric pattern so that when we bend barrels, the pressures are more equal so that we don't get leaning barrels. Once we do that, then we raise that barrel into these skirts, which is called Meissen rows. We're very particular about what piece of wood goes into a specific barrel, so you constantly have to look at it. So now you can see that barrel's just sitting there on its own, you know. You could take the hoops off of it and it would stay there pretty much. And by flattening the top and chasing it around there, getting it even, that barrel straightens itself up. In order to call bourbon bourbon, it has to be aged in a brand new American white oak charred barrel, and that is a law. If you're just making whiskey, you can use that barrel over and over and over again. But as a cooperage, they lobbied to basically to help them keep their jobs. At that point, we have to heat those barrels to certain temperatures in order to make them pliable that we can bend them. We're one of the few cooperages in the country in the whiskey side or the spirit side of the industry that fire bend. Every cooper designs his own cressets. The way you want the heat, the way they breathe and the way they burn, you know, there's a lot to the cresset itself that we actually use. Put the barrel over top of the cresset, and it has to get to a certain temperature in order to change the structure of the wood and make it soft enough and pliable enough to bend. Layers of temperature and heat is what produces the flavor in them barrels. We'll come in and we wet these barrels down, lets the wood kind of relax a little bit. Toast is a toast. It's what it sounds like. You're browning. You're actually starting the caramelization process. You're breaking down the hemicellulose in the wood to convert into sugars, which is what the distillers, the wineries, kombucha makers, that's what they're looking for, is sugars. And it's like Boy Scouts, you gotta keep the fires going. We use all the scrap wood that we use in here from making our barrel ends, use everything. We put barrels on the fire and we rotate them on so that every single barrel is on the fire the same exact amount of time. We use a bender, a hydraulic press to bend the barrels. We pull them in slowly. A lot of other cooperages steam bend. That doesn't do anything for the flavor. And then they'll just bend it all at once. We bend them slowly. Every cooperage is different. I'm a stickler on efficiency. And every process leads to the next process. We have a one-of-a-kind charring process. Our machine was built in Scotland. It was originally designed for recharring used bourbon barrels for the Scotch industry. Our system actually reads real-time temperatures. It's very accurate. So from barrel to barrel, batch to batch, I can produce that same char level. We toast it again. We burst it into flame. So we tell people that we char our barrels with a dragon. Different char levels produce different flavors. So the char is really not what creates the flavor. The char itself opens the wood up and it also filters any impurities out of that spirit. So as a barrel heats up, it expands and it contracts. So when it expands, it pulls the spirit into the wood. When it cools, it shoves back into the barrel. It's a constant mixing process in and out of the wood. And it's taking the flavors from the breakdown of the wood and mixing it into their spirit. As coopers, we're interested in four compounds: lingons, tannins, lactones, and hemicellulose. The higher your char levels, the more smoke and more vanillin you're gonna get. Not much complexity. The lactones are what creates those warm caramel, coconut, bread flavors. So when you char real high temperatures, you're burning the lactones off. Now we find that we get much more complexity out of our lower char levels. Then we cool them. So you can see the dragon blowing flames into the barrel. After we char, and we have to cool that barrel, and they shrink, we have to repress that barrel again to tighten it back up. Then we go to crozing. And we designed all our own croze profiles. The groove is the same shape as what the barrel head is, which in turn makes it a machine fit. We use a wax in our croze. It's a special wax. It stays pliable. It's not, never really gets hard. So barrels expand and contract quite a bit. So that helps us with our leaking process. Once that barrel's crozed, then we bung bore it. We center it up on one of the wide staves and we drill a hole in the side of the barrel. After we drill the hole, we cauterize it. And that's done with an iron. You're burning that end grain because that end grain can leak around that bung and you can lose product. It was Kelly's idea to start this thing. I don't know what the hell she was thinking. My background has been in woodworking and construction my whole life. Built, you know, I've built million-dollar homes. Kelly had gotten a job from Oneida County Tourism here in Utica, New York. So I sold my construction company and we moved to here. Keep your fires up. I did some construction, quickly figured out that's not what I wanted to do, nor was I getting any younger. So she come running in the house one night and said, I know what we can do. And she said, a Cooperage. We use a double Z groove press fit. You can see there's no glue or nails or anything in that. They're pressed together. And once we make these blanks, then we'll char these. And you have to wet them or they shrink and they come apart. That weight on the top keeps them from curling.
There was a serious barrel shortage, 18 months to get an order of barrels. And there were no Cooperages in the Northeast United States at the time. New York State did have Cooperages in the past, but there was this little thing called Prohibition that happened. And really, you know, the Cooperages here in the Northeast just were not able to survive that. So we were the first to build a new Cooperage in New York State since the 1940s.
We put our heads in from the top and we remove all the other hoops. And at that point, then we sand that barrel. And we have a big belt sander and we run that sander and smooth it. There's more to sanding than just looks. It actually closes the grain up slightly and keeps the barrel to the point where it breathes, but yet it's still tight. And our customers tell us that they lose a little bit less in angel share, which is evaporation that's coming out of them. They're going to yield more product out of that barrel. We make all our own hooping in-house here. We buy our steel. It's thicker and it's edge conditioned. A lot of people get cut handling their barrels. So we have it edge conditioned, which means the edges are knurled and not sharp. So we cut and punch her, we roll them, we splay them, which is beveling them, and then we rivet them together, and then we press them on the barrel. And we press everything to the same exact height. Some Cooperages only test a certain percentage of them, but we test every single barrel before it comes out of here. Every barrel we fill with a certain amount of water, which also rinses anything out of that barrel from the building process, cleans it, hydrates it, we check it for leaks. Fix that barrel, sand it off. Then we know that barrel's ready to go.
There were lots of factors that led into the barrel shortage. A big part of it was the emergence of new distilleries across the country. We started looking at what it would take to put a Cooperage together. A couple challenges along the way, of course. The first was really finding anyone to talk to about barrel making. There are no schools to learn to be a cooper. It is still an apprenticeship style industry. You literally have to learn from somebody that knows the skill.
It's a very tight-knit industry. Every Cooperage does things different. They guard their stuff with their lives. It's secret what they do.
We finally found Rick DeFerrari. He's a master cooper, owns Oregon Barrel Works.
Since he was on the West Coast and I was on the East Coast, we're not competitive. He agreed to let me come out. It's kind of a dying craft, and he would like to see it continue. But he was very open. He was very instrumental and taught me how the basics of barrel building. And then I took what I learned and created my own processes. But he did say if I was any closer to him, he would have never let me come. After we pressure test it, then we brand it, label it for char level, and then we wrap it. When they don't wrap their barrel completely like that, the barrels can dry out. In order to get that barrel to stop leaking, you have to rehydrate. You know, with ours, they can, as long as it's been wrapped, they can unwrap it, fill it. Generally, no leaks. You can pay a lot closer attention to detail. These other cooperages that are large and they're machine driven. It's all automated, but I didn't want to do that. I still wanted to be a cooper. I love working with wood, always have. Anything to do with wood, I like it. Like I said, I built million-dollar homes and stuff, but setting up a cooperage and creating these barrels was probably the hardest thing I've ever done.